Hey there, YouTube. Mark here. Today I'm going to do a video on accessories that you need to if you own a reel-to-reel deck player such as this Akai GX630D. Now this deck was quite popular when it came out. You can still find them on eBay quite readily. More or less basic deck though. No special features like auto reverse or Dolby noise reduction, that sort of thing. But it does the job very, very well. And after I purchased this, I realized that there was some things that I needed in the way of accessories for this deck. So I just want to show you what I purchased both at thrift stores and online. Things that make owning a reel-to-reel much more enjoyable. Okay, so the first accessory I want to show you is this little gizmo, which is an audio head magnetizer. And what it is, it's a very small electromagnet, and all you have to do is plug it in, and as soon as you plug it in, you can feel a very slight vibration through your fingers, so you know there's some current going through there and it's working. And the idea is to bring it as close to the tape heads, recording, playback, erase heads, as you can. You can touch it, but if you're going to touch the heads, be very careful you don't scratch them. And the whole idea is you want to circle this in around the tape head area as close as you can get to it, and then just for a couple seconds, and then pull away very, very slowly. And what that'll do is it'll take off any residual magnetism that's left on your tape heads. And this goes for cassette decks as well, or 8-track tape players. Residual magnetism will cause the high frequency sounds in your tapes to drop out, and also it can actually, the magnetism on your heads can actually deteriorate the signals that are input on your tape. So great little device to have, and really recommended for anybody who owns a reel-to-reel or a cassette deck for that matter. So that was the first thing I purchased. Next up is a tape recording tape splicer. Now this little kit came with the Bib recording tape splicer, which is made in England. And I'm hoping the camera, I'll try to zoom in a little bit on it. There we go. You can see that right in the center of it there is a line, a 45 degree angle line, and that is where you cut your tape to splice it. So what you use is just a regular one-sided razor blade, and you would put your tape in here that you want to cut, one end first, cut your tape, and then your second tape the same thing. From this end you want to cut that. Now what, once you've cut them both on 45 degree angles, you want to put them back into the splicer and line them up so that they're touching. Try not to have them overlap if possible, but just touching. And these two little gizmos will hold the tape in place while you splice it. So what you want to do then is to take off a piece of genuine splicing tape. Now this one is made by Scotch, and it's original splicing tape. I'm not sure how old it is. I have used it already. It does work, so I guess it's still good. It is really recommended. Do not use regular Scotch tape when you're splicing your audio tapes, because the residue that is on Scotch tape will bleed through your tapes and cause a real gummy mess, and your tapes will be destroyed. So make sure you're using proper splicing tape to do so. Also, the kit comes with leader tapes as well, four different rolls. So if I need some new leader tape on what I'm splicing, I got that too. And the reason why I bought this really was because I came across a whole bunch of used tapes. A guy in town was selling a whole stack of them, so I bought them all off him. And what I want to do is take the smaller reel and splice them together so that they fit onto the large reel, the 10-inch reel. So, and I've done that a couple times now with pretty good success. And so another great tool to have too. Also, if you wanted to edit your tapes, so take something out of your tapes that you didn't want in there, you can use the splicer to do that as well, to remove unwanted sections. Okay, the third item that I purchased, found at a thrift store for $5.99. And what it is, it's a realistic, or made by Radio Shack, magnetic bulk tape eraser. Now this gizmo works much like the head demagnetizer. It too is an electromagnet, a little bit more powerful though. And what it does, it will take a reel of tape like this, and if you had any residual or any music on there or anything you don't want, or you want to completely wipe the tape clean, which is what I'm trying to say, to wipe the tape clean of any music whatsoever, the bulk tape eraser is the perfect thing to do it. And it'll also work with cassette tapes as well. I'm going to do a quick demonstration. Okay, here's what it looks like. It's fairly heavy, and like I said, it's an electromagnet. And same thing when you turn it on. You can feel the vibration in your hand. The vibration becomes much more audible as you bring it closer to the tape. And what you do is you bring it down. You can hear it now. And you go around the tape two or three times. And once you've done that, very slowly, important, very slowly, pull it away. Okay, because that will ensure that you have removed everything. Just to be on the safe side too, what I'll do is I'll flip it over and do the same thing this way. Okay, that tape is now 100% free of any recording. It's completely blank, returned to its the state that it would be if you bought it new. So, very handy tool. Didn't even know about these things until this, a little while ago. And like cassette tapes too, exactly the same thing. If you've got a bunch of cassette tapes you want to wipe clean and start fresh on, great little tool to have. The last thing I want to show you really is an essential piece, but it's something that I found at a thrift store for very cheap. And I'm going to pan the camera around here again and show you. Okay, so directly below the tape deck here is what I picked up. And what it is called, it's called a Phase Linear Model 1000 Series 2. And I guess to describe what it is, it's a noise reduction system combined with a dynamic range expander. It's not Dolby, it's not DBX. This works on a different premise altogether. It was manufactured in the late 70s and was considered a high-end piece of equipment at the time. And what it does, it works differently than Dolby and DBX. Dolby and DBX, in order to get the results, you need to record your tape in Dolby and then play it back with the Dolby switch in. So what it does is it goes through an encoding process with the recording and then decoding with playing. Same with the DBX, works the same way. This system doesn't require any encoding whatsoever. It takes whatever tape you have and plays it, and it's incredible the amount of hiss that it takes out. Now if you own a reel-to-reel deck and you're using the lowest speed, which is 3 3/4 inches per second, which is what I'm using here, you do tend to get a lot of tape hiss, as really noticeable in the quiet passages. On the faster speeds, 7.5 inches per second, or 15 inches per second, this deck doesn't have that speed. The faster the speed travels, the less noise you get. So many audiophiles who own these decks don't really care about the noise reduction system because they use the higher speeds and they're not really getting a lot of tape hiss. but on 3¾ inches you do get a fair amount. And this really, this machine, this phase linear, does an amazing job at reducing the tape hiss right out of the right off the tape on playback only, without taking out the highs. And that's what I was afraid of. It does that you would lose the cymbals and all the high end on the music, but you don't. It basically leaves that alone and just attacks the hiss by itself. However, you do have to make sure that you have a fine tuning adjustment. This knob here is called it's the noise reduction, which is the correlation threshold adjustment, and you got to kind of fiddle with it to get it exactly right, because if you have it adjusted too much one way, what will happen is you will cut out the highs. And if you have it adjusted too much the other way, you're not going to be eliminating enough of the hiss, or none of the hiss. So it does require a bit of fiddling. Once you get to a point where your hiss is gone, but your highs are still there, that's where you want to be. What makes this kind of different too from a DBX or a Dolby system is that it also has a dynamic range expander, which kind of works in the opposite way. Not really the opposite way, but what it does, it kind of works more or less like a loudness button on your receiver, but not to such an extent. It's a lot more subtle, but at the same time, the dynamic range expander will add a lot of life to an audio recording. And I find that you get most benefit from it from recorded on 3¾-inch speed. It really does add an overall range, extended range on both the high and the low ends. So this machine here, although that this idea never really caught on, it was manufactured in the US, I believe, in 1978. It's working wonders for the system that I have here. And it's not only for reel-to-reels, it's also in the instruction booklet, it mentions turntables as well. If you have a really scratchy record or a turntable that has a lot of rumble, this will eliminate most of the background noise in your records and any noise that your turntable is creating. So just a very cool little system. Very happy to pick this up, and it really complements my reel-to-reel. So anyway, that's about it for this little update on my Akai reel-to-reel deck. And I hope it's been of some benefit to some people out there who might be thinking about getting into this kind of thing. Anyway, take care for now, and we'll talk to you guys soon.